Click here to subscribe our channel. Do not forget to press the bell icon to get regular updates of free videos.
Okay, we'll continue with class number second. Class number two. We'll continue with Lewis model. Now, just to recap from the last class, Lewis model is basically a structural chain theory of development. So, as explained in the class number one, Lewis model is basically a structural change theory of development. And why it is called structural chain theory of development? It is called structural theory of development because it says that during the economic development process, the structure of economy will change from emphasis on traditional sector to emphasis on the modern sector. So, to begin with, economy is characterized by a dualism, which means coexistence of two sectors, one traditional in nature and other modern. When you say it is traditional, it means it uses traditional technology, it uses traditional equipment, the form of organization is also traditional, mainly employed family members as worker. When you say it is modern, it is using modern technology, modern form of organization, hiring labor on wage basis. So, in a modern sector, workers are paid wage according to their marginal product. But in the traditional sector, whatever be the total production on land, that total production is distributed among family members. The wages are determined according to the average productivity. So, to begin with, economy will have a dualism. Due to that dualism, initially there are more workers in the traditional sector. As there is more and more worker in traditional sector, the total product in traditional sector increases but at decreasing rate. After reaching a point, it becomes stable. So, if I say to begin with, all workers were working in the agriculture sector, traditional, then this is the total level of output produced. Out of those labor, if some labor migrate from traditional to modern because of higher wage or better living condition, then if some labor migrate from traditional to the modern, there is no loss of output. When I say no loss of output, it means in that region, marginal productivity of labor is assumed to be zero. So, no loss of output here, but there was increase in output in the modern sector. So, overall production for the economy was increasing. Then it was considered that if agriculture is also modernized, then how much labor it should have employed. For that purpose, you draw that wage line and equated that wage with marginal product. Marginal product is slope of production function. Then the argument was that in this range, that is B to C, marginal productivity in traditional is not zero, positive. In modern also positive, but in modern marginal productivity is more. So, better that labor should migrate from traditional to the modern, because in that case there will be less reduction of output in traditional and more increase in output in the modern sector. So, production again will increase. This was characterized as a surplus labor. This was characterized where marginal productivity is positive but less, as disguisedly unemployed. And this third will be the last phase of commercialization of agriculture. So, as more and more labor work migrated from traditional to the modern, in modern sector they are earning higher wage, more workers earning higher wage, they are creating more and more demand for agricultural good. But to produce those agricultural good, number of workers remaining is less. So, less worker now produces more output. But how that less worker produces more output? That less worker produces more output by using modern technology. So, in that way, the traditional sector became the modern sector, and that duality will go. So, during the economic development process, that dualism will be over. So in that way it changes the structure from emphasis on traditional sector to the modern sector. And apart from that, you have written two extensions, where that is, one was disguised labor, disguised unemployment, and the other was difference between labor and the laborer. So what is said, being said, that labor has not transferred, but laborer has. So person has moved from tradition to modern, but in terms of labor hour, the number of labor hour in tradition remains same. Now this concept has been explained by Ranis and Fay. So we'll start with class number 2 with that Ranis and Fay model. So better to use diagram in 3 part. So just make a vertical form of register. This will be Lewis, Ranis, Fay model. It provides basically a better graphical description. It simply argues that how worker move from traditional to the modern. But remember, as worker move from traditional to the modern, there has to be some transfer of food also from the traditional to the modern, because modern sector is not producing food. So they are dependent upon food produced by the traditional sector. So there has to be flow of worker from traditional to the modern, and along with that there has to be flow of food from traditional sector to the modern sector, because only that will sustain development. To explain this, use 3 part description. First is for industrial sector. So on axis you can write variables like labor employed in industrial sector. So here it is industrial labor. So on that vertical axis you will write industrial wage, industrial labor and industrial wage. Middle diagram you can keep it short, because there will be less description in that middle part, but keep a slightly bigger diagram in that third part. In that third part you write here, rather in the second part you write here industrial labor, and in the third part of diagram just close this from the right side as well. You will measure agriculture labor from right to left and industrial labor from left to right. In this direction agriculture labor, in this direction industrial labor. So there is a given supply of labor. On vertical axis right here agriculture output. So in this direction, in this direction you measure agriculture labor. In this direction you are measuring that agriculture labor. You have to read this diagram bottom up. That means first last diagram draw karenge, uske baad is form mein proceed karna. So starting from this, remember in this direction we have to measure agriculture labor. So first diagram which was drawn is being plotted in this last part here. As there is more and more labor in agriculture, production in agriculture will increase, it reaches a maximum and then it becomes horizontal. So first diagram jo bana rakha tha wo aapne is last diagram mein draw kar liya. Then connect this point with origin to get the wage rate. So slope of this line, slope of this line basically measures wage rate. When it is horizontal, it means labor productivity was zero. So till that point, just divide this diagram into different parts. Parallel to this line there will be a tangency. So parallel to that wage line you will draw a tangency line. From that point again draw vertical line. So your diagram is divided into 3 parts. first, second, and then third. Remember, to start with, there will be more and more labor in agriculture. So you have to read this diagram from left to right. Initially, surplus labor will go, then disguisedly unemployment labor will go, and the final will be the commercialization of agriculture. So in this part, we have surplus labor. This is a surplus labor. Surplus in the sense marginal productivity of labor is zero. After that, this range, it is disguised unemployment. It is disguised unemployment. But disguised unemployment means productivity of labor is not zero, but it is less as compared to modern sector. And in the third phase, it is commercialization of agriculture. Commercialization of agriculture. Third will be the final phase of commercialization of agriculture. Now start with this bottom and then use the first one. So long as there will be surplus labor in industry, there will be a constant wage, and this is basically supply of labor. That means at a given wage rate, there is supply of labor in the industry, which means by giving this wage, industry can hire as much labor as they can. But how much labor they will actually hire, that depends upon demand for labor. So demand for labor is marginal productivity line. So this is marginal productivity of labor in industry. So this horizontal line is supply of labor, this is your demand for labor. Their equality determine employment of labor. So remember, initially this much of labor has been employed in the industry. And from where this labor comes? This labor comes from agriculture sector, traditional sector. So that much labor goes from agriculture to the modern sector. What happens that this area is being interpreted as industrialist profit. But why it is interpreted as industrialist profit? Remember, when you calculate the area below marginal product, so area below marginal product will be the total product. That total product will be distributed between the factor of production. So one factor is labor and the other factor is the owner of that industry. So owner of that industry will have a profit which is equal to total product minus wages given to worker. So if wage given to worker is this, labor employed is this, so this rectangle basically measures the wage and this above area measures the profit. It is being assumed in this model that the industrialist makes profit from one plant, uses that profit to reinvest by setting up more plant. But when that industrialist uses that profit to reinvest and set up more plant, there will be increase in demand for labor. So labor demand shifts to the right. As a result, more labor is employed. Remember that more labor is again coming from this agriculture sector. So long as there was surplus labor, this wage rate will remain same. But once that surplus labor will exhaust, then wage will start rising. So till that point, apne ye mark rakha hai. After that point, it will be started to rise. Ab us linear form mein given nahi hai, usse non-linear form mein jaise diagram use kiya gaya reading mein, waise diagram draw karein. But main point is, after finishing that surplus labor, wage in industrial sector will start rising. That means industrialists cannot hire more worker at same wage. They have to pay higher wages. So after that, again labor demand curve shifts and more labor migrate from agriculture to the modern sector. But now which labor is migrating? In the second phase, the labor which was disguisedly unemployed in agriculture, that labor has moved from agriculture to modern sector. Once that disguisedly unemployment labor will also or already moved, after that means we are referring to that stage 3. In that stage, wage will in industry will increase further. So the slope of that line will increase further. Remember, this is basically referred as supply curve. This is supply curve of industrial labor. Supply curve of industrial labor, and these are the demand curve for labor. So there will be more and more demand curve for labor as industries reinvest its own profit. So in the first phase, surplus labor goes. In the second phase, disguised unemployment labor. Third phase, agriculture has already become commercialized. In agriculture also wage will be higher, in industry also wage will be higher. So worker may or may not be moving from agriculture to the industrial part. Now, what is the main idea in this middle diagram? The middle diagram is expected to explain average agriculture surplus divided by average agriculture surplus, and here it is industrial labor. But what is the meaning of average agriculture surplus? It says agriculture surplus divided by number of person transferred from agriculture to the industry. But what is surplus here? Surplus is whatever has been produced in the agriculture. So this line is basically the production function, and this line is basically wage. So agricultural production minus wage, that will be your agricultural surplus, but it is called average agriculture surplus. So what do you do? That whatever has been produced in the agriculture, that is determined by production function. From that you subtracted wage, so in that way you get agriculture surplus. Wage se jitna jyada production kiya, but that product, that surplus has been divided by number of person migrated from agriculture to industry. In that way it is called as average agricultural surplus. But jyada elaboration content mein nahi aana hai, but just to show it, meaning is clear. Agriculture surplus is agricultural production minus wage. Average because it is divided by number of person transferred from agriculture to industry. In this first phase, that agriculture surplus remains constant, then agriculture surplus declines, and in the third stage it declines further. So basically this three part description is a Louis Ranis Fay model, and the main idea is to explain the process by which economy structure changes from traditional to the modern. So briefly, because the main content is basically uploaded, you must write at least the brief part of this model, just one or two paragraph short, read and first. Economic development proceeds by transfer of labor from agriculture to industry. Transfer of labor from agriculture to industry, and simultaneous transfer of food grains. So there has to be movement of labor as well as movement of food, and simultaneous transfer of food grains that sustains that part of labor force that sustains that part of labor force engaged in that sustains that part of labor force engaged in non-agriculture activity. So obviously non-agriculture activity is mainly here industry. The diagrammatic representation of this process, has been provided by Ranis and Fay. That is why this process, or rather this, that is why this model is also called, this model is also called Lewis-Ranis-Fay model. Lewis-Ranis-Fay model. Lewis-Ranis-Fay model. Next paragraph. As shown in diagram, when there is surplus labor in agriculture, then supply curve of industrial labor is horizontal. Indicating that at a given wage rate, industrial sector can hire more and more labor. However, the demand for labor is marginal product curve. The demand for labor is marginal product curve, and demand for labor in industry is determined by capital accumulation in industry. That means how much plant they have, accordingly they will demand more and more labor. Depends on capital accumulation in industry. Full stop. If industrialists reinvest their profit, then capital accumulation increases, and there will be more demand for labor in industry. So more worker will migrate from traditional sector to modern sector. However, when surplus labor get exhausted, then wage rate in industry will also increase. Ye first point ho jayega. Then wage rate in industry will also increase. Wage rate in industry will also increase. And thereby, it reduces the amount of profit. Because जो wage है वो industries के लिए cost है, तो जब cost increase होगा तो industries का profit reduce हो जाएगा, and thereby reduces the industries profit and also reduces the pace of capital accumulation. Also reduces the pace of capital accumulation. This process of migration from traditional to modern results in economic development. next paragraph. Just give a brief description of that average agriculture surplus. Because remember, whenever you have a surplus, only that surplus can be transferred from traditional to the modern. An agriculture surplus is given by difference between or vertical gap between given by vertical gap between production function and wage bill line. Production function is this one and wage bill line is this straight line. Production function and wage bill line. When we divide this by number of transferred worker, then we get average agriculture surplus. Which progressively declines with economic development. Now remember, when you explain that process, this process also has certain, we can say, limitations or drawbacks also. Limitation number one and most important part is that, apart from other limitation, if you use this diagram here, suppose labor supply is horizontal, labor demand is determined here. So this was the industrialist profit. It was basically argued that industrialists reinvest his profit. By reinvestment, it creates more demand for labor and then more labor migrate. But suppose if reinvestment of industrialist is in the labor saving technology, then that means industrialist reinvest, but in that new plant it uses less labor. So it may happen that labor demand is shifting, but it could be shifting in this manner also. But if it shifts in this manner, then employment of labor remains same. There is no increase in employment of labor in the industry. So if there is no increase in employment of labor in the industry, there will be no movement of labor from traditional to the modern. So the entire process will not operate. So Lewis model assumes that industrialists reinvest their profit not in labor saving technology. So that can be considered as one important drawback. Other drawbacks are that it simply say that there is movement of labor from agriculture to industry, assuming that all labor that moves from agriculture to industry get job in the industry. That means in industrial sector we are assuming full employment. But there could be a situation of industrial unemployment as well. So industrial unemployment has been ignored. It simply discusses that how much is the demand side, how much is the demand for labor. So there are certain drawbacks of this mechanism as well. But apart from these drawbacks, there are certain policies issues. In the reading of Devaraj 10.2, there are certain policy issues related to this Lewis model. So just make one heading apart from this is in this model. Remember, in a paper you will be not getting any short question. The questions are basically either it will be one part of that 15 marks or at the maximum two part. So the weightage of around 8 to 9 marks ka question hoga. So you have to elaborate that model. So Lewis model will have certain policy issues as well. Now those policy issues can be divided into two part. One is agriculture taxation. One is basically agricultural taxation. Now agricultural taxation idea is and the other is agriculture pricing policy. Agriculture pricing policy. Remember the agricultural taxation concept, that in the Lewis model what we have assumed? We have assumed that wage rate in agriculture is fixed. So there is a fixed wage rate in given in the agriculture. Now this implication say that if labor move away from agriculture to industry, remember in agriculture wages are paid according to average product, which is total product divided by labor. But if some labor move away from agriculture to industry, this L get reduced here. So when labor in agriculture get reduced, obviously it will increase what? Average productivity. So the argument is, if agriculture can increase its average productivity, and average productivity is determining the wage, so why not agriculture sector increases the wage? In agriculture sector increases the wage. Now its implication is being interpreted as, if wage in agriculture increases, then to hire worker in industry will become expensive. So there may be less employment of labor in the industry. So what can be done is that when labor decreases in agriculture, this total product, or if labor is declining, if total product also decreases in the same proportion, then average product will remain same. But how total product can decrease? Now it is argued that this, on this total product there is agricultural tax. So farmers are giving tax to the government, but they are paying that tax as a part of their output. So that total product is declining because of that tax. So there is a vested interest of industrialists that agriculture should be taxed, because if agriculture is taxed, then this total product declines, which keeps wage constant. If you don't tax agriculture, then total product will remain same, labor decreases, then wage will increase, and that will make it expensive for industrialists to hire more labor. So it is in the interest of industrialists that agricultural income should be taxed. So that is basically one part of that. The other simply say that why agriculture will be selling output to the industry. That means if farmer has produced some output, how you will induce that farmer to sell output in the market, and why it is needed? If farmers do not sell their output in the market, then industrialists, that is workers working in industry or even in service, how they will be buying that food? So you have to do two things. One, labor is migrating from agriculture to industry, and simultaneously there has to be transfer of food. But transfer of it, obviously, how you can induce the farmer to transfer food? Obviously, for that purpose, they must have produced more, and there must be some incentive for farmer to sell their product in the market. And that incentive comes from pricing policy. Increase the, say for example, minimum support price. So when you increase that minimum support price, you induce the farmer to sell their product in the market. So thereby it get transferred. So there are two mechanisms here. Either government take away some food in the form of tax and then transfer it to the industry, or government can induce the farmer to sell their product directly in the market by increasing that minimum support price, or by reducing the cost of input also. Provide input at a cheaper cost, so that farmer will be having greater surplus, and that greater surplus will be sold in the market. So in that policy issue, briefly you can write certain points. But this is obviously that if question relates to policy issue, then you will add. Otherwise it is not part of directly model. We can say implication of that Lewis model for agriculture taxation and agriculture pricing policy. Just one paragraph, one or two. There are two important policy issues related to Lewis model. A, agricultural taxation, and B, agricultural pricing policy. agricultural taxation and B, agriculture pricing policy. Now next paragraph for agriculture taxation. The assumption that wage rate in agriculture is fixed. The assumption that wage rate in agriculture is fixed until the phase of commercialization is very strong assumption. Full stop. As labor is progressively withdrawn from agriculture sector, then there is more income left for remaining worker. Labor migrate ho jayega, then there will be more income left for remaining worker. More income left for remaining worker to share. In that case, the question is, why don't they share it and raise wage upward? Question mark. If they do then there are two effects. First, the agricultural surplus available to industry is reduced, because agar wage badh jayega to production function aur wage line ke beech ka gap kam ho jayega. Surplus will reduce. The agricultural surplus available to industry is reduced. And second, the compensating wage paid to transferred worker must rise, because if in agriculture wage rises, industry is forced to pay higher wage. Second, compensating wage paid to transferred worker must rise. Next paragraph. Therefore, industry has a vested interest in taxing agricultural income, because it is only through taxation that income of family members stay low as labor is withdrawn. Next paragraph. However, agricultural taxation, next is for this last part, is agriculture pricing policy ke likh rahe. However, agricultural taxation is not the only way to extract food surplus. Agricultural taxation is not the only way to extract a food surplus. As we have seen, this policy has several problems. this policy has several problems. That is, agriculture taxation has several problems. This policy has several problems, like informational, matlab how much is the production actually, that can't be assessed directly by the government. Informational, comma political, because they have a strong farmers lobby. Economic, in terms of they will have low incentive to increase the productivity of land. Political, economic, etc. Therefore, agriculture pricing policy can be used to induce farmers, to sell their output in market, This can be done by increasing minimum support price, or giving lucrative price, the profitable price hoga, and giving lucrative price to farmers so that they sell more in market, In addition, cost of production for agriculture can be reduced. Cost of production for agriculture can be reduced by giving subsidies on input. Suppose for irrigation you provide subsidized electricity, fertilizer has been subsidized. So when you provide subsidy on input, basically you reduce the cost. By reducing the cost of operation, you increase their surplus, and by having more surplus, you induce them to sell their surplus in the market by giving a higher lucrative price for their final product. So on one hand you have to subsidize the input so that their surplus increases. On the other hand, you have to induce the farmer to sell more and more in the market by giving a higher and lucrative prices. So two policy implications of that Lewis model. Mainly this 10.2 was covering that part. So basically 10.2, that main description part 1, first of all explain that structural chain theory, dualism you have to elaborate, then explain that single diagram, two extensions of the labor surplus concept, after that Rannis and Fay, the graphical description of three part, then limitation part, and then the policy issues part. So these are the various sub part of that Lewis model. So Lewis model is over. Rest mein aapne basically main content likha hai, jo detailed description hai, that you can download from site, and if there will be any problem you can ask on that problem. But we will be having one second. एक मिनट बंद करना बंद. So in this class basically we have done this 10.2 Lewis model. Next class will continue with the same chapter, which will be Harris-Todaro model. So next will be Harris-Todaro model. Basically with small classes we can be covering development economics in a shorter period of time, but we will be having some short classes like we have done Lewis model. It could have been done in one single class also, but I have divided this class into two different parts. Similarly, Harris and Todaro model will be again covered in two different classes. So next will be Harris-Todaro model. Thank you.